Okay, hello everyone to today's seminar. And in fact, that's the very last seminar for this calendar year. And it's my great pleasure to introduce today Nathalie Revol. And yes, among others, she's an INRIA researcher at the École Nationale École Nationale Supérieure de Lyon. And she's very well known in our interval community. And among others, she was the chair of the working group that led to the interval arithmetic standard 1788. And without further ado, I think I'll hand over the microphone now to Nathalie, who will be talking about affine iterations and the wrapping effect, and especially on an approach that is based on the singular value decomposition.
Thank you, Andreas, for the kind introduction, and thank you for organizing this seminar. It's a very nice way to keep in touch with the community. So my talk will be about affine iterations and I cannot change my slides. Okay, it works. And so I tried to make a link with the part which is control theory.
Actually, we still have the title slide in the shared presentation.
And what if I do that?
Maybe just stop sharing screen and then reshare. Screen. Okay, now we have it in full screen mode. Perfect.
Okay, and can I go?
Yep, it's working.
Can I go far? Does it change slides?
Yes.
Okay. So I made the origin of this question comes from control theory and from a linear infinite impulse response filter. So I guess you all know already what such a filter is. So you have inputs un and states xn. And the time is a discrete time. So the time steps are called n. And each state depends linearly on the last input, on sum of the last input un minus something. And also on sum, a finite number of previous states, xn minus k. And so the expression for the new state xn is a linear combination of sum of the previous states and of sum of the previous inputs. And did my slide change? Or do you still see the same?
Yes.
Okay, good. And in particular, some colleagues from Paris came to me with this very simple filter. So xn is a linear combination of the two previous states and of three inputs with these coefficients. And they asked me what happens if we give you an interval for the inputs, so the same interval for every input. Can you determine an interval for every state? So an interval x, which contains every state xn. And they wanted to have, if possible, a small interval for the state. And so the interval for the inputs was around 10. Is there a problem? Okay. And when you try to compute this using interval arithmetic, so you replace the u by this value plus a small interval, and what you get is larger and larger intervals. And you can prove that this filter is stable because the moduli of the roots of the characteristic polynomials are all less than one and even less than 0.95. But you can also prove that the interval simulation diverges or converges to the whole real interval, as you want. So it's not what we expected. And the property which makes it diverge is the fact that when you add or subtract two intervals, you add the width. And so when you consider this linear iteration for the state, if you consider the width of the interval, you have to replace every minus by a plus. And so the width of your intervals increases at every step. And so it diverges. And you can prove it by studying the moduli of the roots of the characteristic polynomial of this linear iteration, and one of them is larger than one. So at each step, you multiply the width by something larger than two. And since I want to study it from a linear algebra point of view, I write it using a matrix iteration. So you can write this very same linear filter as the matrix iteration given here. So the new iterate is this small matrix times the previous iterate plus some constant. Yes. And what happens when you do that? You can see that the width of the interval are related to the spectral radius of the absolute value of A, whereas the speed of convergence when it converges is related to the spectral radius of A and not absolute value of A. And so if you compare the two, one, the spectral radius of A is smaller than one, and the spectral radius of absolute value of A is larger than one, and you consider the successive powers of A, at some point, the spectral radius of A power 10 is less than one, and the spectral radius of absolute value of A power 10 is also less than one. And so if you compute using A to the power 10, then your iteration will converge. So I put two values here because A power 10 satisfies this property. It's not the case for the next one, and starting from A power 19, everything has a spectral radius in absolute value, which is less than one. So the one idea could be to compute every 10 steps. So you to compute using A power 10, and it would converge. Okay. And you can interpret it by saying that the time step is too small, and a better time step should be 10 or 20 times larger. Can we do that for any kind of IIR filter? So it would be written in this way, in the matrix way. And for each matrix such that the spectral radius of A is less than one, then you know that at some point, the spectral radius of absolute value of A power k is less than one, and so your simulation converges. But the question is, how can we determine k naught, from which we can do interval simulation without any problem? Well, the only solution I had so far was to try every possible value of k, so a square, a cube, and so on. So it works if you have a matrix and you are patient enough and you compute all of the spectral radius, but you have no formula to deduce this k naught from the coefficient of A. So it's not very satisfactory. You have to try everything and do a lot of computations before you find. And just some theoretical results before I go further. So if you write your iteration this way, xn plus 1 is a times xn plus b, where a is a matrix, b is a vector, and x is your new state. You know there is a problem of convergence of this iteration when, exactly what I said before, when the spectral radius of a is less than 1, you may have divergence when the absolute value of a has a spectral radius larger than 1. So this is a well-known fact. It's not a discovery. I am not going in the... OK. So I wanted to find something more general than trying every possible powers of A. And actually, this problem is well known, and it's related to the wrapping effect, which has been well studied by many people. And I will just follow a paper by Lohner in 2001. So the problem we have here, and the notations are put here clearly. So I have a matrix which is of dimension d times d, a square matrix. I have a vector x naught of dimension d as well, and the vector b of dimension d. And the problem is to compute the iterates xn plus 1 is equal to a times xn plus b. And what I want to do more specifically is to have some uncertainties on the x and the b. And so in green and bold fonts, it's an interval value. So I want to compute the interval xn plus 1, which is a, so not interval matrix, a scalar matrix times xn, with x again an interval, plus the vector b. I would like also to be more careful with Randolph errors in everything I do, but it's not done in today's work. And I also would like to replace A by an interval matrix A, but it's not done in today's work. And so when you do this kind of computations, you face the wrapping effect, which has been described by Lohner. So you probably know this this figure already. So you have a square and you make it turn, and each time you make it turn by an eighth of a turn, your square becomes a square the border, the yes, are not parallel to the axis, so you have to put it in this larger square and you turn it a bit more and you get an even larger square and so on. And so you see that after quite rapidly, you should preserve a small square, but you get a large one because you have to put your square in the box with slides parallel to the axis. Okay. And where does this wrapping effect appear? So about everywhere. So in the matrix iterations I just described, if you try to simulate a dynamical system, a discrete dynamical system, you get something which is similar to the previous iteration, or more complicated one if it's not linear. And if you integrate a continuous dynamical system, you also get an iteration which looks like the one I want to study. If you study different equations, again, what you get is something similar. So the new iterate is a linear combination of the previous ones. If you have a triangular matrix, bounded triangular matrix, you get something similar. If you do automatic differentiation, you get something similar. So this iteration I want to study is archetypal of the wrapping effect in all of these cases. And so I told you that I had a method which was very peculiar to address this problem, and I wanted to get a more general one. So I know my iterations will diverge. I just want to make them diverge as slowly as possible. And so my idea was to precondition the system either using QR or SVD, and this was in the spirit of a well-known method due to Lohner, which is also called QR, but it's not the same. So I will show the three of them now. So the idea to simulate this iteration is to replace this iteration by another one with a linear change of coordinates, B, such that the new iteration behaves better. So the new iteration is given below. It's y n plus 1 is b minus 1 times a times b times y n plus b minus 1 times the vector b. And how can we choose this change of coordinate b? A natural idea is to choose an orthogonal transformation. So the first possibility, the most straightforward one is to factor the matrix of the system A as QR, and Q is orthogonal, and to use this Q matrix to change coordinates. And so the idea is to replace the xn by Q times yn, and to iterate on yn, and then when I want to get xn again, I just multiply by this orthogonal matrix Q. And so the iteration satisfied by yn is given here. So yn plus 1 is r times q times yn plus q prime or q transpose times b. So this will be our first preconditioning to multiply everything by q or q prime, q transpose. And if we do that, we can prove that the we can prove that the widths of the iterate grow, and they grow as the condition number of some matrix power n times the spectral radius of A power n. So this one is natural, we cannot do anything else. And here we have a condition number power n, and the condition number is larger than one. So we are not, I am not that happy with this bound, but I didn't manage to do better. So if we want to go into details, so Q is an orthogonal matrix obtained by the QR factorization of A. And if I assume that A is diagonalizable, then A can be written as some matrix times a diagonal lambda times the inverse of P. And this is where P appears here. Okay, so this was the first idea, use the Q in the QR factorization to get an orthogonal matrix and to change coordinates using an orthogonal matrix. If we use another factorization of A, we also get some orthogonal matrices. So if we factor A as in SVD, as U times D times V transpose, and U and V are orthogonal and D is diagonal, then we can use either U or V, whichever we want, to change coordinates. So in this slide, I use U. So I will consider that Xn is U times Yn. So I will work with Yn. And I get this iteration, Yn plus 1 is something with the U, which appears a bit of everywhere. And I have another orthogonal matrix, which is V. So I can do the same with V. And this is what we get. We can change coordinates and get another iteration with a V matrix, which appears everywhere. And again, we can prove that the widths of the iterates grow. Okay, I have a problem, sorry. And again, we can prove that the width of the iterates grow as the condition number of the same P as earlier, times D the dimension, times the spectral radius of A. And all of this is to the power N. And so I was, again, not very happy because the condition number of P is larger than 1. D is the dimension is larger than 1. And so I have something larger than 1 power N. But I didn't manage to do better. At least I have a proof of the widths of the intervals. And lastly, I want to compare with an already well-known method, which is due to Lohner. So again, Lohner uses QR factorization to change coordinates and to have something which is more orthogonal than the initial iteration. But Lohner does much more computations than the one in the method that I propose. So the method of Lohner is at each step, we compute Q times R. Q is orthogonal and R is upper triangular. We compute a new matrix. So this is the factorization of the previous matrix of the iteration. We compute a new matrix, which is R times Q. And we use this new matrix to compute an iterate. And when one uses this method, one knows that this iteration here converges to with the R, which gets diagonal. And so we have nice results on the convergence of this iteration. And you can see this the consequence of these nice results in the bound here. So when one looks at the width of the iterate by this method, one gets a condition number times the spectral radius of the matrix power n. But you can see that the condition number here has no power n. So it's much better. There is a power n less
here.
So one can expect that this method gives more accurate results than the other ones. So we'll do some experiments now to check it. So I did the experiments with Octave and the interval package. I did some try with MATLAB and INTLAB, but I didn't have enough time to redo every experiments and to present them. And Rum said that with the fine arithmetic, the results are much better. And it's not so obvious, but I didn't have time to make a thorough comparison. So this is everything I will present is done with Octave. And the matrices I used are matrices with a prescribed condition number. And you obtain these matrices by typing this command, either in MATLAB or in Octave, both work the same. And I recall that when I did some experiments on another problem, these matrices were too nicely scaled. And this was, in a sense, a bit too easy to solve. So I do some unscaling after that. And unscaling is simply multiplying left and right by a diagonal matrix, so left by D and right by the inverse of D. And the diagonal, this diagonal matrix has largely varying elements on the diagonal. And usually when you do this, you degrade the condition number of your matrix A you had before. So in what I do next, I will vary the condition number and the scaling of the matrix. All matrices are 100 by 100, and most of the time I will do 100 iterates. And just beware, on every plot, the y-axis is in log scale. And I don't know why Octave gives me such no full printing, but this is a log scale in the y-axis. So if I try with a well-conditioned matrix and well-scaled matrix, 100 iterates, the condition number is something like 2 to the square, and the scaling is 2 to the square as well, so 100 for each. The spectral radius of the matrix is something like a half. The spectral radius of the absolute value of the matrix is larger, it's almost 4. And you can see that the condition number of the matrix and the condition number of the P matrix, which is used for the diagonalization, both are small. So everything is well conditioned, well scaled, everything. And so on the curves, what you can see is in green, it is the method where I compute the best power, the power of A such that the iteration converge. So here the power I need is 4. And in every plot, the green line will be very low, very accurate. So this is the tightness of the intervals. So this is a very tight interval. In black, this is the width of the interval if you do nothing special. You just compute the iteration as it was given. In light blue, it's the QR method I described. In dark blue, it's a QR method of Lohner. And there are two curves here, a red and a magenta, and it's difficult to see the difference. Both are based on SVD, the red may be based on U and magenta on V, but okay. And so you can see that the queen, if you manage to find the power of A such that you have convergence, of course everything gets better. Otherwise, for a small number of iterations, the brute force method is the best one. For a larger number of iterations, Lohner's method is better. And here you can see that the SVD method is better than Lohner's method. If we now go, my mouse doesn't work well. If we now go to ill-conditioned matrices, but well-scaled, so you can see that the condition number is almost a million, but the condition number of the matrix for the eigenvectors is nice. What you get, again, the Greek curve is very low, so the width of the interval you get with the power of A is very good. The brute force is very large, except for a very small number of iterations. And then you can see that Lohner's method and SVD method are not too bad, are comparable, and the QR method without loaner's trick is better than the brute force. Then, okay, this is more or less the same, but I do less iterates so we can see better what happens with a small number of iterates. So we can see the green curve is the interval you get with the green method is tight. Loaner's method is of order one. With SVD, it's a bit larger. And the brute force method becomes worse once you have 10 iterations, something like this, or 12. Okay. If we look at the well-conditioned matrix, but ill-scaled, so you can see that the condition number of the matrix was supposed to be something in the 100 or 1,000, but when you unscale it, you get something large. And the condition number of the matrix of eigenvectors is large as well. So what happens? Here, the brute force method gets the best results. So you do less computations and you get tighter results. And if you look at the other methods, at first, the SVD method gets better results, and then Lohner's method gets better results, and the simple QR method is always the worst. And now we go to ill-conditioned and ill-scaled matrix. And here you can see that Lohner's method is clearly the best one, and then the brute force, then SVD, and then QR. But for a small number of iterations, it's not so clear the SVD method is better. So if I try to sum up these results, if you have a large number of iterations, what happens? So you can see what happens if your matrix is well-scaled or ill-scaled, well-conditioned or ill-conditioned. So I put the comparison, larger than means better than, and this means much better than. So when everything is well-conditioned, Lohner's QR is much better than every other method, but the brute one is not that bad, and it's much cheaper. And when the matrix is ill-conditioned, then you can see that SVD is not that far after Lohner's method. And the worst one here is the brute force method. So this is for a rather large number of iterations. If you have a small number of iterations, then things are not so clear. So if everything is well conditioned, the brute force method is the best one. But if the matrix is ill conditioned, then both Lohner and SVD give similar results. And then the other ones are not that good. So to conclude, when the matrix is well conditioned, then the naive method works best, and so use it. It is the cheapest and it gives the most accurate result. When the matrix is ill-conditioned but well-scaled, then Lohner's method and SVD give the best results. However, it's not the same cost for both of them. So for Lohner, at each step, you must perform a QR factorization. And so the cost of one QR factorization is D squared, is Z cubed, sorry. And you do this at each iteration. So the total cost is N, the number of iterations, times D cubed. Whereas SVD requires only one factorization before everything else. So once you do this D cubed operations, and then at each iteration, you do a D squared computation. And so the cost is much lower. And when the matrix is ill-conditioned and ill-scaled, then the best method is Lohner's QR, because things go wrong, and the only thing you can do to prevent things to go very bad is to use Lohner's QR method. And I've gone quite fast, but this is already the conclusion of my talk. So in conclusion, the problem we tackled was to compute iterates, linear or affine iterates. And the problem we encountered was the wrapping effect. And the solutions we considered were either to determine a power of the matrix such that doing this, the computations with these powers gives no difficulty. But this is, it's difficult to give a general. You must try every possible power k such that until you find one which works. And which means you have to compute a spectral radius for each k you try. So it's not, it works, but it's not a very generic method. Or you can choose to transform your coordinates using an orthogonal matrix, so either QR or SVD. And when you do some experiments, you can see that the only method which converges is this, the k power, so this one, k power method. And when otherwise, if you don't, if you cannot use this method, if your matrix is well conditioned, well, do not use anything sophisticated, just do your iterations as simply as you want, as you can. And then if your matrix is ill conditioned and well scaled, then use either Lohner's method or SVD. SVD is cheaper. And if everything is ill conditioned and ill scaled, then Lohner's QR method is the best method. And as a future work, so I told you that I did my experiments only using Octave. And so I didn't have access to a fine arithmetic in Octave. So I want to redo these experiments in MATLAB with Intlab because I have a fine arithmetic, so I will be able to compare. And also I told you that in my theoretical bounds, I was not very happy because I had the powers of n, so exponential growth of everything. And this is due to the fact that I didn't have any nice property of the SVD decomposition to use. And for Lohner's method, the nice bound is based on the fact that there is a nice property on the QR method he uses. So probably I don't know enough about SVD decomposition, and I want to dig in further in the properties of this decomposition to try to find a better bound. Not sure I will find one, but I can try. And another thing which is not very satisfactory is the fact that the matrices I used are matrices that I create artificially. So I would like to try with some more real life matrices, either taken from the integration of ODEs. And these ones have a very peculiar form because it's the identity plus H times some matrix, and H is small. So we're not too far from the identity. So maybe we can take into account this property. Or to use matrices taken from real life control theory. So in this case, the matrix A is companion, and probably we can benefit from the fact that there are many zeros in this matrix. And something I didn't do because everything was diverging so quickly is to have an interval matrix. I used only scalar matrix so far. So I would like to try with interval matrices to check which kind of property I have to consider to know whether it will diverge or not. And also there is a more or less recent paper by Van der Hoeven and Jacobson about certified SVD. So the SVD I used so far are the numerical ones given by Octave or MATLAB. And they give a method to get a certified SVD. So I would like to try to use this certified SVD in my computations. And now some references. So I have three slides of references. I will show them slowly if you want to refer to some of them. And that's it for me. Thank you for your attention.
Many thanks, Nathalie, for your very interesting and clear presentation. And I also think, since you will give me the slides afterwards, I will put them on the webpage, and everyone who is interested in the references can just have a look at the PDF document then afterwards. Yes. Okay, do we have any questions from the audience? Yes, Luc.
Good. Hello. So thank you for this nice talk. So I hope you can hear me.
Yes.
Just about your first equation. So you have something. You have an equation with a discrete time equation where you have u n minus 2 plus u n minus 1 plus u n. You remember at the beginning, almost at the beginning. Yes, something like this. So I don't understand here. So the fact that you do not normally when we what we could do in this kind of situation that we extend the state space, and instead of taking as a vector state x n minus 1 x n minus 2, we also add so that to incorporate u n minus 1 and u n minus 2. So I don't know if you here you take a state vector of dimension 2, but due to the fact that you have u n minus 1 and u minus 2, you could also extend your state vector in order to have no to take into account the dependency between the different u. Do you understand what I mean?
Yes, here I've put everything into one single interval.
Yes. So you are a little pessimistic, and it is maybe due to the fact that you multiply by a small number.
The main problem is due to the fact that the spectral radius of the matrix is, when you take the absolute value of this matrix, the spectral radius is larger than one, and so it makes it diverge.
Okay, so for your example, you could have taken, for instance, un.
Yes.
Okay, yeah, I understand this. Now, if you want to, I understand that your box is not positive invariant, and you have to apply several times A.
Yes.
So that you will enter inside your initial box. But you could also maybe have taken an ellipsoid, and in one step, you will be inside, you will be sent by A inside your ellipsoid. I mean, your ellipsoid will be positive invariant. You understand what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And this ellipsoid, you can easily find it by solving a Lyapunov equation. So it's, you can easily find it, this ellipsoid, which is positive invariant. And maybe after, so in one step, you will be inside the previous ellipsoid. And maybe you can use interval approach to guarantee that you will be indeed positive invariant. So do you understand what I mean? And why don't you use ellipsoid in this kind of context? Because you just consider box, of course.
Yes, I consider. Actually, when you consider the trajectory of each point, it converges. When you try to consider the set of initial values, you know it will diverge, and I just wanted to diverge not too quickly.
Yeah. Okay. Okay.
But I didn't try ellipsoids.
So that's all I think I have well understood. So thank you. Thank you for this nice talk.
Okay, then I think the second one who raised the hand was Xu.
Yes, it's me. Hi.
Hi.
So thanks you for this nice talk. And I have one question in the experimental data here. And in your resource, you give an example with a matrix A with 100 dimension, 100 times 100. And I'm wondering, did you try with the small dimension matrix A, such as 10 times 10, or the results will change or not?
Yes, I tried with 10 times 10.
Yes.
And the conclusions are more or less the same.
Ah, more like the same. So
yes.
The convergence of different methods such as QR or VST, it doesn't concern about the dimension of the matrix A.
But if the dimension is smaller, then it gets better.
Ah,
and
okay.
If the the dimension is smaller than the SVD is better, even if it's ill scaled.
Ah, okay, got it. Mm. Okay, thank you. That's my question. Thank you.
Thank you, Shun.
Okay, the next one who has raised their hand was Benam Hashimi. Please go ahead.
So can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Right. So thank you very much for your nice talk. I especially liked your K-power idea. I think I will use it in my future work. So hopefully if I have your slides, then I can understand much better. But so I did something similar. I used some similar ideas in a different context where you have the weighted sum of Chebyshev polynomials, and you want to enclose the final result. So what I did was to first rewrote the problem as a discrete dynamical system, like you have here. And then I used the eigenvalue decomposition of the matrix, the iteration matrix, similar to what you did in part of your work. So then that turned out to be a very good idea, especially if the depth of the recurrence was large, that is, if the degree of the polynomial was high. So details are available in my 2019 ACM TOMS paper, if you are interested to take a look.
Yes, please.
Yeah, so that's my only comment, no, really not a question. Okay. So I can send you a link to the paper on the chat, if you like. So if you would like, then please just go directly to section 4.3
okay.
of that paper. I have also done something on enclosing matrix exponential, where you have to use powering up, compute powers of interval matrices and matrices, and then I guess even in that context, your ideas might be very useful.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
And yes, the idea with using SVD was to align along the vectors where you have the largest. The SVD gives you the vector where you have a small vector, for instance, which is the most enlarged or the opposite. And so this was the idea of using the SVD to align with what is more elongated.
Mm-hmm. So I just used the eigenvalue decomposition, but I can imagine that SVD could be useful also in some other context.
I was also interested in eigenvalues, but the eigenvalues mm-hmm. just tell you mm-hmm. how one direction is stretched.
Right.
But it doesn't give you the one mm-hmm. which is the most stretched or the least stretched.
Yeah.
And the singular values this is what they give you. The directions which are most or least elongated.
Yeah, so I guess the main reason I used the eigenvalue decomposition in that context was that I could, so my matrices were just 2x2, so they were small, and I could explicitly compute the eigenvalue decomposition. And I guess the SVD was more time consuming, so I guess that was the main reason I used the eigenvalue decomposition in that work. But yeah, so. And I can imagine that there, in some other context, maybe SVD is the best thing to do.
Well, my idea was to align things with the direction mm-hmm. which is the most elongated.
Yeah, great. Yeah, fantastic.
Maybe let me comment on this a little bit, because I think the singular value decomposition approach, this always, regardless of the eigenvalues, leads to a real valued problem formulation at the end.
Yes.
When you're computing eigenvalues, and if you have rotations, you typically have oscillations in the background, and this means you have complex valued eigenvalues. And for the complex eigenvalues, you could, in fact, transform the state equations into some, let's say, complex valued modal system representation where you have fully decoupled sets of equations. And then you could perform the iterations in a complex valued domain. That's also something that I did together with Katja Auer for some exponential enclosure technique for continuous time system models. But it turns more or less the formulation much more complicated. And I think those two approaches that Nathalie and also Benam were talking about, they're really very similar in the case that you have purely real eigenvalues. And in this case, maybe it even is not necessary to discuss about the most elongated directions in the state space. But I'm not 100% sure with respect to this last comment, but with respect to the other, that you really have to complicate it or get more complicated formulations in the case of complex eigenvalues. I think that's really something where from the singular value decomposition you can benefit. Okay, do we have any other questions in the audience?
Yes,
Luc?
Yes, I would like to have some kind of intuition why a fine interval arithmetic could provide some better results than the typical loaner method, for instance. Is there some intuition?
Well, this is what Siegfried Röhm said, but when I tried fine arithmetic, I got large divergent. I didn't do very thorough experiments, but in the small experiments I did, it was behaving the same. And I think whatever I do, it will behave the same because you don't align anything with the direction where things happen. So I don't think it will.
Yes.
I don't know why it should be better.
Yes, but maybe they have an intuition. Maybe they have an idea that but to me, I don't see why it should behave better.
I don't know either. I am not convinced, but I cannot say it doesn't work better. Yeah. I have to check it.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. My intuition is that it's the same.
When you have no uncertainty on U, everything is easy, or you know, when you have the term U, everything is linear, and probably you are able with the Lohner method, all method, you are able to compute the exact.
I wanted to show you the theoretical bounds and. So this is for loaner, and for the other one, it's a bit the same. So if U is a scalar, then this is zero. Yeah. So you just cancel this term. But the most important term is the first line, which is, so you have this spectral radius of A power N. So this converges to zero, it's not a big problem, times something. And for loaner, this is not too big. And for the other methods, you have this condition number which appear with the power n. So the width of the U is not very important, but this is what happens here, which is most important.
Okay.
You have a condition number, so something larger than one power n times something else.
So you mean that the Lohner method is still pessimistic compared to the exact one?
No, the Lohner method will diverge because the iteration diverges, whatever you do. Yes. So you have no choice, the interval will grow.
Yes.
But with Lohner methods, they grow less quickly than with the other ones.
Okay, but since you have a box at the beginning, your box will converge to zero.
No.
No, in your initial system, it was not a stable system.
No. If you follow the trajectory of each point, it will converge.
Yes.
But if you try to follow...
So if you try to compute the image of each corner, the image of a box...
Yes.
Will be a polygon.
Yes.
So you are able to compute the exact image of the box without any pessimism.
Yes.
So probably the Lohner method, due to the fact that it adds some pessimism somewhere, it will be less accurate than if you compute the exact image. But you could, in this example, compute the exact image if you have no uncertainty on you.
In the paper by Nedelkov and Jackson, they show how pessimistic Lohner's method is. So they study the width of the resulting interval. and they show the width of the exact interval, and they show that the pessimism due to both. I don't remember exactly what it is.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
This discussion here directly, I think, brings up one possibility to combine your transformation approaches with the K-Power method. Because, for example, when you're using the SVD approach or also the QR decomposition approach, what you could do is use a small power of the matrices A, let's say K equal to 2 or 3, and then maybe even the pessimism gets reduced a little bit, but just by using the powers of A, and then combining it with this SVD approach or also the QR decomposition technique. That you do something in between,
yes,
between your two methods.
I don't remember how. I think at the beginning the powers not in the examples I gave where the power was small, but in some examples it increases, so it's getting worse and worse, and then it decreases. So you have to stop with the right K, the right value.
The question is, if you have the absolute value of A, what is happening with the spectral radius for small powers of K? If, for example, it directly starts to decrease, then you could benefit. No. Or if it starts to increase at the beginning, then you have...
Yes.
Then things may turn even worse at the beginning.
Yes.
Okay, now I see John has turned on the camera. John, do you have a question?
Hello. I just wanted to thank Natalie for an interesting talk, and I've been listening to all the questions, so I haven't got a particular question myself, except it does seem to me that the behavior of the spectral radius of powers of absolute value of A is surely very dependent on the geometry of the transformation, and whether there is rotations going on in the background and that sort of thing.
Yes.
I just have one philosophic question. You said at the end that you're is making a distinction between small numbers of iterations and large numbers of iterations. How do you define small and large?
I was just looking at the curves, and I thought that at the beginning there were interesting things. So this is...
Okay, this was just, let's say, from
visual,
just as defined by the visualization.
Yes.
Yes. Because the reason why I'm asking this is, for example, when you have a control system, linear discrete time dynamic system, where you want to analyze observability or controllability, what you have to compute is the powers of the matrix A up to the number of state variables that you have. And for this analysis, let's say, for example, if you have your 100 by 100 matrix, you need the powers of A till the power of 99 in this case. And from that perspective, I think, for example, concerning controllability or observability matrices, yes, 100 as the number of iterations would be a small number.
Mm-hmm.
And everything when you're performing simulations of the dynamic system, or for example, when you want also to use, yes, let's say the temporal evolution of the solution of the discrete time dynamic system to perform something like a robust design of feedforward control strategies, or maybe even something related to a robust flatness-based control technique, then you would use a number of iterations that is much larger than 100 in this case. And my question was just
when
related
I did
to this.
More iterations and the curves went on in the same. You can guess what happens next.
Yes, yes. In this case, it's just exploding.
Sorry. Yes. And you can see the rate of explosion. And so for all of the curves, what is interesting, the behavior differ for small values. And this is what you can see on the left part. And after a while, everything is ordered and will not change anymore. This is my definition of small.
Yes. Okay. Okay, and maybe one final question. If I look at this figure here, what you could do is, I'm thinking again as a control engineer at the moment. What you could do, if you have your system model, this AX plus BU, you're typically designing a feedback controller in the sense that you define U as something proportional to the state vector X. You have something U is equal to K times X. And what you could do is then maybe to generalize your approach in such a way that you're searching for, let's say, a controller gain with minimum norm that guarantees you some kind of contraction properties. Just to search for a controller gain that is avoiding this explosion. And then this would be something like a nice trick to find some upper bounds of the convergence rate towards a stable equilibrium.
Mm-hmm. Yes, in my example, U is constant, or the interval for U is constant.
Mm-hmm. Yes, in your example, it was constant, but when you're designing, for example, a feedback controller, you have some, an additional degree of freedom, namely the controller gains,
no
that
feedback.
You could tune directly using, maybe your method.
Maybe the other reaction could be the time step has not been properly chosen. And we should choose a larger one. And choosing the larger one corresponds to choosing the kth power.
Mm-hmm. Or maybe the discretization method was not chosen properly in practice, because what you had at the end was an explicit Euler method that you mentioned. And this typically enlarges the spectral radius. But what you could do is you could use an implicit Euler method. And this typically reduces the spectral radius.
Yes.
Okay, it has also further disadvantages. An unstable system may appear stable.
Mm-hmm.
But that's something you could use maybe for discretizing if you have really very short sampling step sizes. That's something one could do in practice.
Yes.
Okay. Any further questions in the audience? Okay. I just have a look at the list of participants. There's no one who has raised their hand. Okay, then again, many thanks, Natalie, for your interesting presentation.
It was nice to see all of you.
For the discussion. And since this is the very last time for this year, I wish all of you not only a nice weekend, but also have nice Christmas holidays. Have a very good start into the new year 2022. And we will continue our seminar on the 14th of January. And the speaker then will be Sergei Petrovich Shari. And for those of you who are familiar a little bit with the old Russian calendar, that's the old Russian New Year on which he will start the seminar. That means we can celebrate a little bit in the very first seminar in January. Hope to see you very soon, and have a nice Christmas holiday and come well into the new year.
Thank you.